It is a great pleasure to be here and to be part of this conference. My topic is new logic, is new probabilities. What do they mean? In a sentence, I can tell you the following. The idea is that we have different logics available, like many-valued logics, intuitionistic logic, paraconsistent logic, blah, 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 blah. And logic is very much connected to probability. So why changing logic? Will you have or not new theories of probability? So, and if you do, what do they mean? So my intention is to try to show you that, yes, when changing logic, we can change probability theory, and they have a nice and different mean. And by using them, we add an arsenal. We add something to our arsenal of rationality. We'll be adding some new rational tools that will be quite useful in science, in philosophy of science, in decision theory, and so on. So this is joint work with Juliana Bueno Soler and Abilio Rodriguez. Abilio will be talking at this conference as well. So my goal is that logical pluralism is the view that there is more than one correct logic, and probability theory can be seen as extending logical system. So I argue then that probabilistic pluralism is perfectly justifiable, given the connections between logic and probability, illustrating with an example, at least one example, the rational defense of this approach. So probability theory is, of course, essential for statistics, which in turn play a crucial role in philosophy of science, and thus accepting probabilistic pluralism impacts the philosophy of science in a positive way, I suppose, and I intend to show you. Okay, so what I'll be concentrating here on paraconsistent probability theory based on these LFIs, ideologies of formal inconsistency, is a particular family of probability theory. Basically, the only difference between this logic and classical logic is that we can divide the events in the world into two categories, the consistent ones and the inconsistent ones. The consistent ones are like classical logic. Everything is okay, no contradictions, no problem, everything is fine. But there are some events that are sort of inconsistent, like I have they are lot sort of vague or fuzzy or imperfect information, when sometimes I have too much information, blah, blah, blah. And paraconsistent theory is able to treat them as well. Paraconsistent theory is able, as much as classical logic is able to treat coherent or consistent information and to take the best out of them. Paraconsistent theory will be able to treat incoherent, inconsistent, contradictory information and to take some juice out of it, okay? And then I'll be talking about it and showing you an example and giving my final remarks, so please, next one. So I'll be talking about this idea of logical pluralism. Logical pluralism is the idea that there are many logics. Some philosophers do not accept that. Some philosophers are against that idea, so they'll be called the monists. A monist philosopher is one that believes that there is just one possible way of reasoning, just one logic possible. Nowadays, most of philosophers are pluralists, in the sense they do accept that there are different logics, that different logics lead to different mathematics, and even to different foundation physics. So there is more reasons to accept pluralism than monism, but that's not my topic here. I just would like to remember a quotation by Stuart Shapiro, who said that mathematical models generally, in general, there is typically no question of getting it exactly right. For a given purpose, may be bad models that are clearly incorrect, and there may be good models, but it's unlikely that one can speak of one and the only one correct model. So Shapiro is sort of agreeing with me in the idea of considering different logics, because there are different contexts different reasons, different ways of looking at information, different ways of organizing information. And I'll show you as an example, how can this, this kind of reasoning will lead to useful reasoning tools. Okay, next one, please. So there are different ways then of combining logic and probability theory. Logic and probability theory can be combined in a different way. Some approach focus on extending the language of logic by adding some new operator so as to express notion of probability, right? For instance, I can logically regard the probability as a new kind of modality. Then I will be able to construct a new modal theory, modal logic, which will convey some information on probability. But also, I can regard logic and probability in a different way by finding a probabilistic semantics to logic systems. So, for instance, if I have intuitionistic logic and I am able somehow to give a probabilistic semantics or probabilistic interpretation to this intuitionistic logic, I will be connecting logic and probability in a different way, not by adding a modality, right? But by adding something different. So, for instance, a quotation by Ernest Adams in A Primer of Probability, he says that the definition of probability functions requires notions from classical logic. And in this sense, probability theory can be said to presuppose the classical logic. Next one. But I really cannot agree with Adams from at least in this particular way. His view is very narrow in this concerning probability. So it's not true that probability requires logical classical logic. It does not require classical logic. It may require some kind of logic, but not classical logic. Right? If probability functions profit from non-classical logic, if it is true, then probability theory is not presupposing classical logic. I may very well be reasoning in probabilistic terms by starting from a new logic. So this conduces us to the idea of a probabilistic pluralism, right? And my point is to try to show you what's the point in more than one theory of probability measuring. Because this may lead to a certain confusion. Say, if there are so many different theories of probability, because you say that different logic will define a different kind of probability measuring, how can I choose one from another? Well, that's a philosophical question. I'm not going to solve all possible philosophical questions in my talk here. So maybe given some effect, you may choose one certain logic and one certain theory of probability. Given another one, you require a different one. By playing, you really don't need anything more than classical probability theory. Because everything is well given, is well defined, information is clear. Maybe someone is lying, but everything else is okay, so there is no card which is a king and not a king, right? Cards are a clear meaning and so on. But by making decisions in real life, maybe you really need something more than classical logic. So it seems natural to accept the probabilistic pluralism when we accept the logical pluralism. But the big question is there any sense of accepting, for instance, in particular, paraconsistent, intuitionistic, or many-valued probability variance? I show you that, yes, there is, or there are good senses. Okay, next one, please. Okay, so, for instance, classical probability theory due to Kolmogorov takes as primitive the unconditional probability and gives the well-known mathematical laws that connect logic and, not logic exactly, but connect mathematics with probability. So mathematicians and physicists and engineers, usually when they talk about probability, they talk about probability on events. Whatever an event is, they say that they have a space of events and I am attaching numerical values to them and they constitute a good probability measure if they follow Kolmogorov action from common graph definition, but logicians usually do not talk about probability being attached to events, but on the contrary, being attached to logical statements. That makes a subtle distinction. I'll discuss this distinction in the next slide, please. So conditional probability is defined in classical probability theory as the quotient of the probability of A and B divided by probability of B if probability is non-zero. And in particular, we have that the probability of something given its negation is zero, right? If it is not, if probability of negation is not void, is not zero. Why? This conveys the meaning that probability of a negation does not make any influence on the probability of event. So, and something and its negation are completely independent in the sense, okay? So, but is it really necessary? Is that true that always, in all possible cases, the probability of a negation of something never influences the positive probability? Maybe not. And we may have situations where this kind of thing is not necessarily valid. Next slide, please. So to deal with it may happen that information about negation is not trustworthy, is vague or abundant. So in this case, I will have a certain non-zero probability of A and not A, right? I show some practical cases on this thing may happen. So sometimes, the probability of a certain event or a certain sentence A and not A is not necessarily zero. And in this case, I will need a new notion of probability. It will be justifiable to have a new notion of probability. And for this reason, it's convenient to think in terms of sentence instead of in terms of events, as you will be showing in the following slides. So, in classical reasoning, classical probability, it makes no difference if you are thinking about events or in terms of sentence, because of a mathematical fact. Both of them, sentences or events, they make a Boolean algebra, right? So in classical logic, thinking about facts, so intersections, complementation, blah, 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 and negation, conjunction, disjunction is the same thing, because when there's only one way to attach a Boolean algebra to assign sets to Boolean algebra, and sentences in classical logic are an example of Boolean algebra. So they are exactly the same, they are indiscernible. But when we leave classical logic and go to non-classical logic, this makes some distinctions. This makes some distinctions. So thinking about probability in terms of sentences and thinking about probability in terms of events is not going to be the same thing, because non-classical logic do not necessarily follow Boolean algebra, right? So in a certain sense, if you are play in the Boolean kindergarten, everything is okay, everything is the same. But outside the Boolean kindergarten, things get a bit more messy, a bit more complicated. I will try to show you. Next slide, please. Yes, in classical logic, negation is explosive. So what does it mean? That from information alpha and a negation of alpha, I am able to derive any possible beta, right? But for a consistent logic is this investigation of logical systems where negation is not explosive. So I do not necessarily go from deriving any possible consequence starting upon a contradiction. Low, this is, of course, what happens in classical, in real life. I ask an information about to someone about a certain street and I receive from two people, two contradicting information. I do not derive that the sky is blue, is red, or something crazy like that. I just ask for more to confirm my information. Just this kind of a contradiction, instead of being something that I'm throwing away, is going to be very useful for me to think again about my presuppositions, about my making questions, about my way, of interviewing people. You know, it's going to be something useful to for me to correct my stance instead of getting crazy for nothing. Again, another place. Okay, so these LFIs are kind of special kind of consistent logic, as I said. They internalize the notion of a consistency, marked by a white ball, an inconsistency marked by a black ball in the language. This permits the system to express different levels of consistency, which allow to make sensible inferences in the presence of contradictions. What do I mean by different levels of consistency? Some contradictions or some inconsistencies are not very much important, like if it's cold today or it's hot today in Porto Alegre. Maybe some people say it's hot, some people say it's not hot. This kind of contradiction is not important. But a contradiction in my password is very crucial, it's very important. Because if there's just one symbol missing, one uppercase or lowercase, I'm not going to be able to enter in my account or my bank account or whatever. So some kinds of contradiction are very sensible. Some others are not. And para consistent logic, it makes us be possible to measure or to be able to see these different degrees of incoherence or inconsistency, right? So this leads to the following point. The notions of consistency and no contradictions are not coincident, nor are the notions of inconsistency and contradiction the same. So I'll be completely separating the idea of a contradiction for a consistency. So then we have to add it to logic, just one new principle, this principle of gentle explosion, which says the following. I mean, contradiction does not explode by itself, but a contradiction about something consistent does explode. Okay? So explosion is recovered for coherent situations. So what's classical logic within this logic of formal inconsistent? Classical logic is exactly the logic of consistent statements or consistent situations. Right? If everything is consistent, classical logic applies, and then a contradiction is untenable. I cannot sustain any contradiction. It will lead to an explosion. But para consistent logic makes we able to distinguish, to make a distinction between coherent or consistent situations and non-consistent. And the only thing we had to add to classical logic is this principle of a gentle explosion. If I add that, I have a new logic, which is para consistent logic, is a new logic, which is sort of enlarging classical logic, not denying it, but it enlarging it. And this will reflect on theories of probability. Next slide, please. Just very briefly, there are many different paraconsistent logic. Some of them are many valued. Some of them are non-deterministic, blah, blah, blah. I'm not going to bother you with details of logic, but just to show you that there are several different logics. Paraconsistent logic, some of them are many-valued, three-valued, others are not many-valued, blah, blah, blah. So I'll be concentrating on just one example, but there are many of them, and each one of them will give you a slightly different theory of probability. Next slide, please. Okay, so for instance, LFI1 is a three-valued paraconsistent logic, CIE, is one of the weakest systems of a hierarchy where contradictoriness and inconsistency are identified. Let F is a logic of evidence and truth, which is an extension of the famous far-valued logic FDE, which has been worked out by Michael Dunn and Belknap. And so I think that my colleague Abilio Rodriguez will be talking about this Let F very possibly in his talk. Again, next one. So this picture gives you a sort of a mathematical understanding of the foundations of a the foundations of the connections between probability and logic. So in the bottom of this picture, I have classical probability theory and Boolean algebra. As I said, they are very much connected. So if I talk about Kolmogorov effects, or I talk about probability on sets, they are both of them very much connected to Boolean algebra, so that it makes no difference. So logicians and philosophers, well, they're not going to fight about how to use classical probability. But then the next line shows classical probability theory in probabilistic semantics, because I have a sort of completeness. Again, they will be very happy to be talking about two different sides of probability. Philosophers will concentrate on logic itself. Mathematicians will be more concentrated on a mathematical theory, which is closer in spirit, is closer to topology in some sense. It's just a mathematical theory or measure theory. But then when you go up to paraconsistent probability, we also have a probabilistic semantics based on LFIs. But on the right side, because I'm coming from algebra, you have the algebra, which is a Boolean algebra, generalization of Boolean algebra. But on the left side, I will be not very in good terms, because I will be meeting some algebraic counterparts of paraconsistent probability theory. So this is, I mean, I don't say that this is impossible, but that is where research nowadays is stopped. We are stopped in finding good, I myself am working on it, on finding good algebraic models of paraconsistent probability theory. We don't have it for the moment, but it does not impede us of using it, of employing it to real problems. Again, so I have a very standard way of attaching probability to logic. If I take any logic I like, I may think about non-negativity. I mean, probability is something between 0 and 1. Tautologicity, that is, if I derive a sentence phi, whatever, in my logic, be three-valued, many-valued, paraconsistent, or whatever, then I attach the probability to 1. I mean, tautologies have probability to 1. If something is an anti-tautology, I mean, some explosive particle like a bottom particle, like in classical logic, it would be alpha or not alpha, and in paraconsistent logic, it will be alpha and not alpha, and alpha is consistent, it's a kind of bottom particle, then I attach probability 0 to it. Next one is a comparison. I mean, if psi entails phi, then the probability of psi is less or equal probability of phi. I mean, the sign here means whatever logic entailment relation means. I mean, whatever it is, I will be faithful to this criteria. And finite additivity means a connection between this means a connection between not negation, but a connection between disjunction and conjunction in my logic. If my logic obeys that, I have some finite additive theory, which is very useful for probability. If I miss one of these kind of things, there will be a very rare and very complicated probability theory. I don't know what to do. So all my theories obey this. Okay. For instance, let me give you. Let's concentrate on this theorem. The theorem shows the following. Only probability of alpha or beta is the sum of alpha or beta only if they are logically incompatible. Otherwise, this equality is not going to be good. So number two is very important. Number two is very important. Probability of consistency of alpha. Remember that consistency is a logical symbol, right? I can compute the probability of something being consistent. Is 2 minus the probability of alpha plus the probability of minus alpha. So in classical logic, probability of alpha plus the negation of alpha is always one. So probability of consistent will be always minus one equals one. So in classical logics, everything has the higher degree of a probability attached to its consistent, but not in my paraconsistent probability theory. Number three is also very important. Probability of alpha and not the alpha will be probability of alpha plus probability of not alpha minus one. So it may give me something non-zero here, right? If, for instance, probability of alpha and not the alpha is bigger than one. Okay, so just to remind you about the idea of conditional probability. So I'll be using here the same definition of conditional probability. So there's no novelty here on defining a new, I mean, not defining a new notion of conditional probability, although it can be defined, and there are some discussion about ways of defining conditional probability. But for the moment, I'll be restricted myself on the same conditional definition of conditional, classical conditional probability. So just to make things clear, we have to make a kind of a generalization of idea of partition, right? A partition, you know, is something which is I will be separating some space in parts that are mutually mutually exclusive, and you cover the whole space. So what I call a cleavage is a family of propositions, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha n. A cleavage is exhaustive if alpha 1, alpha 2 provides a tautology. A cleavage is exclusive when alpha 1, alpha 2, blah, 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 are pairwise logically incompatible. And then an exhaustive and exclusive cleavage is a partition. So a partition is a special way of dividing things that were very classically connected and so on. But some kind of a cleavage of the space are only exhaustive. That means they cover the whole space, but they are not pairwise logically incompatible with each other. I may have alpha 1 and alpha 2 be something which is not a contradictory. It's not completely a contradiction. They have some measure. And exclusive in the other sense, they may be completely logically incompatible, 1, 2 by 2, but they do not cover the space. So I have, in classical, in terms of logic, they will be connected to too much information, to feel information, excessive information, and to feel information or less information. And then have the idea connected to logics of paraconsistency on one side, paracomplete on the other side. For instance, intuitionistic logic is paracomplete in the sense that alpha or not alpha does not cover the whole space. Yeah, so this cleavage here, for instance, shows that this the second blue figure shows that alpha and not alpha are not completely covering space, but I have some alpha and not the alpha is something which I have to take into consideration, right? Cleavage. So I have, then this gives me, if I start from my theory of paraconsistent probability, two different ways of considering the classical theorem of total probability theorem. I will be organizing things differently. So in the first one, version one, I have probability of beta is the conditional probability beta given alpha plus beta given not alpha minus the probability of something in alpha being inconsistent. So it may happen that there is some inconsistency happening in regard to alpha, and then in order to compute the probability of beta, it's not only sufficient for me to consider the part related to alpha and the part related to not alpha. I have to discount, I have to take off something which was connected to the inherent combination of alpha and not alpha. So that's one way of looking at theorem paraconsistent total probability, considering this black ball. Another way is to be considering the white ball and the black ball. So probability of beta is the condition of probability, conditioning on constant of the alpha, plus considering the other possibility of conditioning only inconsistent of them. It's like if I'm taking an important decision and I'm trying to buy something very expensive, a house or an apartment or an expensive car, and I'll take some information with the people that are trying to sell me, and I have to really consider two different scenarios. One scenario that people is telling me everything which is true and correct, so everything is white ball, but they may be telling me something which is not completely right. And then I have to take into consideration that is some information may be black ball. I mean, they may be not completely coherent. They may be vague or partial, or they are not telling me the whole truth, or etc. So in real life, I really need to consider two different scenarios, right? And to have a very nice and useful decision theory, I will have to look at these kind of things. And this is one way where paragnostic probability theory can be useful. Next one, please. Bayes' theorem, as you know, is very classical way of a fantastic, useful way of updating my belief in order to take into account new information. This is a classical version of it. Probability of alpha given beta will be computed based upon the probability of beta given alpha and beta given not alpha. So again, next slide, I show you. We also have a different way. Yeah, now this is a paraconsistent Bayes theorem, which is very interesting application of paraconsistent probability, because it takes into consideration, look at this black ball here, it takes into consideration the possibility of the information being inconsistent or incoherent, right? So if things are not completely classical or completely perfect, I have to take into consideration that my decision will involve some possible contradictory information. As I said, by considering this total probability theory, I have to exclude a bit of information because possibly there is too much information involved and they are causing some contradiction here. Another way of a consistent theorem, Bayes' theorem version 2, I will be now using the second form of the total probability theorem. I only will give attention to information being coherent or incoherent, consistent or inconsistent. Pay attention here that I don't have any negation involved here, but what I do have is a consistent Bayes theorem asking about the probability, conditional probability, talking about the consistency of the alpha, right? So if I want to know how much consistent is alpha given information beta, I take into consideration how the information beta according and given the consistency of the alpha, time is the consistency of the alpha, divided by beta consistency of the alpha, but plus beta taking into account the inconsistency of the alpha. So this is a very useful, I show you an example. It's a very useful way to look in, for looking at information will give me some nice results. Another one. Now I give you a concrete example of how this can be used. It's a very simple example, but it's paradigmatic, and you can use it to take decisions in several other areas of reasoning. So suppose I have a Bayesian spam filter which analyzes suspicious characteristics in the body of messages. So this is classically, that's what it happens in most of the time. So I consider the headers, the senders and the message path, what are they suspicious or not? The presence of a HTML code Net als with Camus, HTML code may be suspicious. They have perhaps too much colors, suspicious words, suspicious expressions, etc. Some words or characteristics of a message are suspicious, but some are just dubious. So, dubious or suspicious, maybe if I receive an email with in the body of it, I have written sex, buy something, get instant cash, special present this link, blah, 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 blah. I am very sure that this is a suspicious message, but sometimes it's just a dubious, like I say free or, right. If I say now, free, maybe just a innocent propaganda, maybe not some malicious phishing or scam that you're trying to cheat me, right? So just dubious. How can I make this distinction of what something is dubious, suspicious? How do I take all the information? Let's give you an example. So suppose that historical probabilities coming from the training data are the following. Probability that something is spam is 30%. So probability that any given email, arbitrary email is spam is 30%. And the probability that it's not spam, it's a so-called a ham, is 85%. Though this decision is measured by independent methods. And that is why the probability of being a spam plus not spam is greater than one, right? If you sum 85 with 30, it's more than one. 0.3 plus 0.85 is more than one. But what do I do? How can I, what do? Do I throw everything away? I destroy all my information? No, we don't need it. We can use a nice probability and take profit of this possibility. Let's suppose that both searches are very good measuring method. They are only because of they are found different instances of training, they found a different measure. So suppose now that for a given characteristic W, I define the conditional probability of W being a spam is the conditional probability that a message containing W, given that it's a spam, computed by the proportion of the spam containing, I'm just making an approximation here, saying that this conditional probability can be equal, can be given, can be computed by the proportion of spam that contains these characteristics. For instance, the word sex, whatever, right? Or free cash. I take all possible messages, many, a big amount of messages, and measure how many of them are spam and have this free cash on it. The probability of a spam being a ham is the contrary, right? It's the probability of W being not spam, considering that the message contains W, and is a ham, again, computed in proportion. Of course, here, spam intersection and ham is not empty. So what I have here is that I have a kind of inherent contradiction between the ideas of spam and not spam. They are, if I compute them, they give me 0.15 or 15% more. I have a surplus, right? So as an example, suppose that probability of a certain characteristic being spun is 0.9. Characteristic of, I have this like a free cash characteristic. Being non-spun is 0.2. And the probability of having this characteristic and this span, this notion of span I'm using, being incoherent, is small but not zero. It's 0.01. So making all my calculations, I compute here that the probability of something being span and having these characteristics like free cash is 61.6%. even if my measure is not perfectly well done. I have an imperfection in my measure. I have an inconsistent in my idea, in my measure of span here. But even so, I'm able, by using this paraconsistent Bayesian theorem, I'm able to give, to take some information out of it. So let just to compare paraconsistent classical analysis here. So I may say, okay, I will divide the world into three possibilities, right? I have a no span at all. I just forget about span. Then I restore PS and P not F, 30%, 70%. In this case, I compute my classical Bayes theorem, and I my result is this 65.9. I may say, okay, my information is not clear. I will consider them half and half. Again, if you sum 22.5 and 77.5, you have 100%. And I use my classical theory again, and I get 6.6. Or I may say, no, I have everything which is controversial is a spam. And again, I have 44.3. But my paraconsistent probability finds a compromise in the situation. Using my probability theory, I do have a new number, which is not compared to any one of the classical scenarios, which is usually what engineers do when they have a contradiction, right? So I don't have to clean the scenario in a way. I can compute with the dirty or incoherent, inconsistent scenario, and I get a new number, which is not the first, neither the second, nor the third one. So what does this mean? It means that by using a new and a paraconsistent probability measure, able to have a different measure. Okay, which one is better? I don't know. It's just different. I'm just telling you that using a new probability theory, I do have a new and, I mean, a good reasoning tool in my hands. I can do my calculations without cleaning these previous scenarios, and I have some useful information. So considering everything, considering that the information about spam is contradictory, considering how much contradictory it is, in this case, only 15%, blah, 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 I can give a good account of the probability of something being a spam, given these suspicious characteristics, even if it's not perfectly, the information is not completely perfect or completely classical. So let's go to our final remarks here. So as we have seen, there are different paraconsistent probability theories. The essential distinctions among them are different versions of total problem, which are different ways of organizing the information. Sometimes I can organize information in a certain way. Sometimes I don't have a means to organize the situation in this way. I can organize it in a different way. And this way of computing the total probability theorem may be useful for me. Each version allows us to organize data, possibly contradictory, offering different views of the same question. Again, next one. Another one, please. So among that philosophical defense, the only philosophical defense, or the best philosophical defense I can give you, is the following. By considering this new theory of probability, I have more reasoning tools in my hand. I have more ways to deal with decision theory. I have more ways to I have new tools of rationality at disposal, right? So if probability is really a branch of logic, why to be restricted to classical logic? So our view goes against the traditional view that non-contradictoriness, I mean classical consistent, is a requirement for rational belief. Contradictions can be informative, and I can reason with incoherent or inconsistent or contradictory beliefs. I don't need to clean my belief is if I regard probability theory as a way of express my rational belief. I can be contradictory belief. I can be contradictory if I sense of a certain complicated situation. I can take into account different contradictions, different contradictory scenarios, even if they have inherent contradictions inside, and I will be able to take something out of that. So other logic views of probability are of course possible if they regard data differently. So why not to be a happy pluralist and have more ways to compute your chances? This is my final remark for you, my final something to bring home, people.
Hello. Hello.
As Barry said a moment ago, some moral thing that is next one. We have just a thank you. And thank you, everyone. That's it for today.
Thank you very much. Great for your excellent talk. And so we have some time for questions. Julio Stern has written here, there are several concentrated transformations.
Maybe I read it.
No, okay. Consecrated.
Consecrated.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah, maybe
then
I read it.
Read it, please.
Okay,
please.
First an objection. Probability on events and probability on sentences are equivalent in a affinitary context. But real probability and statistics are done in someone wrote and my chat moved. So real probability and statistics are done in the continuum. They're moving from probability on events to probability on sentences is not that trivial. Can you comment?
Yes, of course, yes, you're right. So this finitariness or infinitary conditions are very much discussed. Looks like some philosophers consider that there is no meaning in talk about infinitary situations, but I agree with you that in physics and engineering, in mathematics, people really need it. So the infinitary law is accepted. It's really possible to do the same thing by using paraconstant probabilities, but we still need some mathematics behind it. You know, Julio, the problem is we do not have anything like the notion of a space in paraconstant probabilities, because we don't have enough resources on set theory, enough resources on algebra, right? We are still working on it. But I myself and Marcelo Conilio and other people and Juliana Bueno Soler and Abilio Rodriguez, we are working on this idea of completing the scenario. But yes, it will be possible for sure, because that's a mathematical problem. It's a mathematical, it's like when you go to transfinite set theory. It's a mathematical tool that's when you do it, then you are free to do more. So I have no doubt that we can adapt all these things that people do in infinitary scenarios to paraconsistent probabilities, but given the time, not right away.
Okay, maybe a tool that we can use is instead of using first order logic, using second order logic. But
yes,
second order logic is damn difficult.
You are completely right. Maybe, but even doing that, even going to second order, but a consistent logic is not a trivial thing. First order is okay. We know we dominate it. Second order, nobody knows anything about it. Yes.
So and then I have a question.
Yeah.
There are several consecrated transformations of a probability measure to another measure. For example, there is a well-known transformation from it takes you from a probability measure to a possibility measure.
Yeah.
Can any of those transformations be made equivalent to a transformation in the underlying logic?
Excellent question. I don't know if we can make a transformation, like a smooth transformation from one to another, but we can really think about possibilistic theory. Like you yourself, you call it Kreidel calculi, right? Kreidel calculus is a calculus where you are talking about your credences, your beliefs, and it's possible to build, and we have done that already, it's possible to build a theory of a possibilistic logic by means of paraconsistent, starting from paraconsistent logic. Yes, we can. Well, the only thing we cannot do is how to make a smooth transformation from one to another, as we do in the classical cases. But I don't think it's impossible. This is very, we did not do it. We did not try it, but it's very possible.
Thank you. Thank you, Walter, Julio. So Marco Silva has a question.
Yeah. Hi, Walter. Thank you.
Hi, Marco. Thank you.
I'm kind of cooking now.
Okay. Nice for staying here.
Thank you for your talk. A more general philosophical question, Walter. There's a hot discussion on realism and anti-realism concerning logic. Yeah, you know very well this kind of discussion. So when you elaborate your account of probability in terms of sentences and not in terms of events, are you assuming an anti-realist approach to logic? And also, does this anti-realism have any relation to your view on rationality? I was kind of missing some your view on this topic. You did not really elaborate your view on rationality, yeah. Although you said that your account on probability is a contradiction, a contribution for it. Thank you, Walter.
Okay, thank you. Again, a fantastic question. Well, I do not assume any philosophical stance on realism or anti-realism in order to build my theories. What I think is that, on the contrary, once these theories are built, they will have a consequence on the discussion about realism and anti-realism. No? Just on the contrary. So people talking about realism now, they have to take into account that there is another theory on probability that brings on different logics and so on and so on. So the idea is that it's not that I'm starting from a philosophical point. I'm using probability on sentences because that's what philosophers do when they talk about probability. And because we do not have a theory of paraconsistent events yet. So to sum up, I'm not starting from any philosophical point here, but I'm sure that this discussion will have a philosophical consequences.
In your concept of rationality, Walter?
Well, my idea of rationality is that rationality is not restricted to logic, right? Rationality is much bigger than logic. When you talk about analogy, when you talk about rhetoric, argumentation, smells, for instance, smell can give an olfactory argumentation for you, but it gives information. Or, I mean, there are many, many aspects in life that give you more information or make you conclude things differently than logic. So I think that considering new types of probability theory adds to our arsenal of rational tools. That's what I mean. So I'm having more tools at my disposal, right? And sometimes I do not have a logic attached to it. In this case, I do have a mathematical formulation. It comes from logic. Logic comes from a mathematical structure of a logical probability, logical theory, and so blah 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 blah. So, but even this mathematical way of things gives me new and unsuspected rational tools, right? So I'm adding to our arsenal. Why to restrict them?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Marcus, Walter. So there are some compliments here, but I don't think we have at this moment another question, but people can write, you can write in the chat. And so they can ask afterwards about your presentation. Your presentation will stay available in YouTube if you permit it.
Yes,
so
sure.
People can interact in the next month or so, and also in the next year. So I really thank you very much. I know that predictive brain theories are looking very much on accounts, are praising accounts about probability, and I don't know, but I see many future possible application for this kind of systems. So thank you very much, Walter, again, to be here with us, and see you soon, I hope.
Okay, thank you very much. Yes, I'm glad to hear that, and I am available. Anyone writing to me, my email address at Unicamp or Gmail address, just walter.carnielli@gmail.com. I'll be able to send you, I'll be glad to send you my papers and preprints and full articles on everything I have. And I'll be very glad to discuss to anyone willing to go on further on this discussion here. Thank you very much, and thank you for discussion.